So, all right. Welcome to, guess what, a conversation on critical perspectives on technology. My name is Katja Spiel, and I'm an FWF Hertha Firnberg postdoctoral scholar at TU Wien, where I research marginalized perspectives on technology to inform critical design and engineering. My pronouns are they, them, and my sign name is... this lecture series is a part of my research project on exceptional norms, marginalized bodies, and interaction design, and supported by the Human Computer Interaction Group at TU Wien. At the beginning, just as a quick access check-in, we do have subtitles that you can enable by clicking on the CC button. They're automated subcaptions. We will have stretch breaks at the half hour and the full hour mark, and Ashley just posted a link to the slides that they might be partly using. Anyway, today you are here to hear from the cyborg Jillian Wise and Ashley Shu. Ashley Shu is an associate professor of science, technology, and society at Virginia Tech. Shu works on philosophy of technology at its intersection with disability studies, animal studies, and emergent technologies. She serves as co-editor-in-chief of Techne, a journal of the Society for Philosophy and Technology. And she's a co-editor of three PhilTech volumes and sole author of Animal Construction and Technological Knowledge, a book from 2017. Her current research is about techno-ableism and stories disabled people tell about technology that challenge tropey norms. The cyborg Jillian Wise, with the pronouns Cy, she, or hers, is a poet, video artist, and disability rights activist. Cy's books include The Amputee's Guide to Sex from 2007, the novel The Colony from 2010, The Book of Goodbyes from 2013, and Cyborg Detective from 2019. Her work has appeared in the New York Times and Granta. Cy's next book is a memoir, Common Cyborg, out from Houghton Mifflin Harcourt. They both will be cyborgs in dialogue. So you can ask questions during and after the presentation in the chat window or however they tell you to. And afterwards, we will all be in discussion, which will be led by Matthias Forstner, who has studied at the Johannes Kepler Universität JKU in Linz and thereby received a master's degree in business informatics and in sociology. And he is the beneficiary of the Promolecht stipend for people with disabilities by the Austrian government. Thus, since 2019, he is working at the JKU's sociology department and writing on his doctoral dissertation about models of disability. But for now, Jillian and Ashley, take it away.
Thank you very much, Katja. I want to do an image description. I'm a white woman, cisgender woman with a messy bun, and I'm a cyborg wearing a heating pad in an office with a plant that's barely making it with a window and my blinds are not quite open. I invite comments in the chat with the acknowledgement that if we have any low vision or blind participants, they can't read the comments in the chat. So just an awareness of that. At the same time, an awareness of neurodivergent participants who may prefer the chat. So so what else is there access wise to say? I think that's it. I will confer to Ashley.
Hey, I will image describe myself, but as you were like talking about heating pads, I have at least two stacked by my desk, the sort of cyborg gear you need in order to do your work each day sometimes involves things like that. So I'm laughing as you're describing these things because it's highly relatable content for this.
Yeah.
I am a white woman with like reddish blonde hair. I'm sitting in sort of a white angular room. And I have a lovely like portrait of a cat behind me and a bookshelf. I'm really excited to be here today to talk with you guys about cyborgs, about techno-ableism, and be part of this Exceptional Norms series. I'm also laughing every time people read out Jillian's titles. And of course, I'm a fan. You can see I have multiple books. I can't own a copy of The Amputee's Guide to Sex because I am an amputee and I do not want people to take that title seriously and think that I need an instruction manual about how to have sex. So I have not read anything from Amputee's Guide to Sex, even though I'm a fan.
They do take it as an instruction manual.
It is
only a book of poems. I am but a poet who sometimes writes prose. So I understand your dilemma there. And I'm so excited to be with you. And I was actually realizing that I don't know what brought you. I mean, we're ostensibly going to talk about being cyborgs, which is to say, we're going to talk about our lives. What brought you to STS, to science, technology, and society, to the field?
Oh, well, I mean, I was in it before I became a cyborg.
Oh, awesome. Okay.
So I became, and I was lucky from my vantage point in STS. So I work in philosophy of technology and have for a while now. And I was teaching on some issues around cyborgs. I actually, when I got my cancer diagnosis that led to a lot of my disabilities, I was teaching a class on cyborgs and I had to hand the whole thing over to one of my colleagues. And I was also, you know, teaching with a disability studies lens on some of these things, but I didn't think that it was the right thing for me to do research on. Yeah. Like I was happy to read and be a recipient of a lot of those stories. I was happy to teach about like cochlear ear implant controversies in my medical dilemmas class. I was really interested in disability and technology, but as a recipient of that scholarship, as an interested academic, it was not what I was doing my primary work on. As it turns out, I've always been disabled, but we didn't get a diagnosis for my Crohn's disease until in between bouts of cancer. Do they call it bouts? I don't know if that is the right terminology. So I probably had always been, although I wouldn't count me as a cyborg in that way, but there's like a definite date when you're an amputee where you lose your leg and it's harder for people to pinpoint those things down. I mean, for some people it's at birth, for some people it's a gradual process of chronic illness. So there's sorts of, you know, different considerations about how to join a community there.
Yeah, well, let's talk about that for sure.
Can I hear a little bit about how you got here, Jillian, and to talking about cyborgs in your—
Yeah,
in your
sure.
Because I've read lots of your work.
I got that, thank you. Well, I'm first and foremost a poet and I was born disabled. So my first prosthetic cyborg leg is like this tall. I didn't think of myself as a cyborg. I was of course very aware. Everyone made me very aware of Donna Haraway's A Cyborg Manifesto in graduate school. But it was so contrary to my ideas of cyborgs. And I was also a little bit frustrated with her for not including deaf, disabled, and neurodivergent women in the manifesto, that it seemed like an inaccessible word to me. However, I'm a poet, so I'm only really interested in words and especially names. And so I came around to the identity in 2010, wrote Going Cyborg and thought, that's it, I'm done with it. Like I've said, I'm a cyborg. What else do I need to say? And then I said it again in the New York Times in 2016. I said it in Granta. And then with the plague, I think especially, and with not being believed, which happens to disabled people all the time, I didn't really expect it in regards to claiming an identity. Usually when people claim an identity, there's some kind of affirmation rather than doubt. But with claiming this identity, I have been met with a lot of doubt. So this brings me to the cyborg, Jillian Weissa, and the pronoun Cy, which is a huge relief to not have to silo disability from gender. And so, yeah, that's kind of my background. But like what you were saying, like, could it happen at birth that one is a cyborg, or when does it happen, is I think all evolving as we articulate cyborg personhood and distinguish it from like triborgs. As for my part, I think that anyone can be a cyborg who, you like, there's opinions, right? Like there's a spectrum of opinions. Like you have to be mechanical or electricity has to be involved. I mean, for me, I use a computerized me, but I even pause on the verb use. Like, mm-hmm. Do I use my tongue? I guess I do. Like I have a tongue, I have a computerized me. And okay, so that seems really obvious, but I'm not a gatekeeper. I'm open to anyone claiming cyborg identity. The only thing is I only recognize disabled and trans people as cyborgs. I don't recognize biohackers who are non-disabled and have like a chip in their finger as cyborg. I just don't. So for me, it's first and foremost disabled and trans. That's kind of where I'm at.
Yeah, I've been thinking a lot with some of your work about this idea of fundamental interface. Mm-hmm. Right? We talk about this in relationship to your leg. And I'm someone who has a prosthetic leg that is not computerized.
Yeah.
And it's really, some of your work has caused me to question, like, in fact, when I think about what counts me into the category of cyborg, I'm more quickly to think about my port. I have this like thing implanted under my skin here.
Yeah.
That can be accessed with needles, but once it's accessed with needles, I can be hooked up
mm-hmm.
to a computerized pump to get different infusions for chemotherapy infusions. Some of that could be for Crohn's disease. Some of it could be for cancer. There's people who get infusions for all sorts of reasons. But I think about like, this is the part that talks to the computer.
Right.
Right. Where I don't have, like, even though I wear a prosthetic leg, I don't need computerized parts on it. It actually, having computerized parts on a limb like mine would make it much heavier and probably less useful to me. And I'd probably work worse, right? Usually we think of computerized as better, but in fact, in the world of limb amputation, that's not always the case. So I've started to think about fundamental interface in that way. And that lets me like think about specific types of disabled and trans people too.
Yeah.
And how we are, you know, it's not just changing our bodies. Mm-hmm. It's, you know, something like thinking about doing basic life tasks. And I hate to like appeal to any language that gets legally encoded, but that's language from the Americans with Disabilities Act. Like we're doing fundamental, you know, tasks in our lives with things that are implanted, or our bodies are changed in order to use technologies.
Yes.
So I'm changed here. I have this port that can be hooked up. You can kind of see like I have a weird bump out here. Like my body's been altered to be more convenient for technology to fit on it.
Yeah.
And that's not being a biohacker and just like, oh, I've put a chip in. I can do like, you could do those things by other means. But so many of us, like we choose to alter our bodies. I think about ostomy bags in this realm as well. So I guess I'd love to hear some of your thoughts about fundamental interface there.
I mean, you just blew my mind with it. I mean, I completely agree with you. And wow, I think I was just trying to make a distinction between the way cyborgs get used as this all-encompassing. Everyone is a cyborg. We're all attached to our screens right now, for example, or our phones. Yes, our phones, right. And for me, when I get but I'm always on my phone, or when I get the sincere person, like I would be really anxious without my phone, my response is, and you would have a new phone within the week. Like you would then have your interface back in shape, like promptly. But I wouldn't have a leg in a week if I didn't have a leg. So that's part of my thinking is eroding the universalism of the cyborg. Disabled people who are cyborgs sometimes really like Marvel movies and depictions of cyborgs. Like, that's not me. I don't know any Marvel movies, so I don't find any I don't get any kind of role models from Hollywood, in part because Hollywood has so substantially and consistently excluded disabled people. But I'm for that if disabled people find something there in affirmation of cyborg identity. What is the fundamental interface? What is that about? Well, I think it just goes back to naming or trying to find names that affirm a kind of personhood rather than anything else. Like, also with thinking of common cyborgs, thinking of class, thinking of race, the ways that common obliterates the Silicon Valley tech bro concept of an elite cyborg, is that's interesting to me too. Yeah. So yeah, I think that's where I'm at with it, but I'm also subject to change. I'm subject to be challenged too. I'd love to be challenged. I mean, I'm open to being challenged on any of this. I've already been challenged by a group of disabled scholars in Berkeley years and years ago, who said, you're not cyborg, you're going through a phase and you're gonna grow out of it. And I was like, no, I'm growing into it. I'm growing fully into it. But what did they mean by that? I don't know, but I speculate they meant that that would somehow deny personhood rather than affirm it. This was also back in 2008, for some context. And so I think that disabled elders and scholars have done a lot for us to feel proud calling ourselves disabled people, but I want more than that. I want more affirmation even than that. So.
Well, I really like your thoughts on that, because I can understand a certain resistance to the term cyborg, right? Yeah. Sometimes disabled people have been told we shouldn't call ourselves that. Yeah. So when we have another term, it's we've worked so hard just to get people to utter the word disabled. You can't give us a new term, especially one that does, if you're thinking about Marvel movies and you think about some of the narratives about disability that suggest we have to overcome our bodies through technology. In general, disabled cyborgs, I know. That's not how they think about it. When I think about cyborg, I think about my body being more subject to material frailty, right? To be more subject to the medical gaze, to be the subject of physical therapists and occupational therapists and people who think they have expertise about what it's like to be me without even talking to me. So the work cyborg does to me, speaks to our technologized disabled lives. And it means that not every disabled person is gonna be a cyborg in my mind.
Right.
That's okay. You could talk about a subgroup within a large group without that being problematic. I can think about people who may be subject to materials for a period of time and then don't want to be in the future. So people get these ports removed, right? Yeah. There's a period of time where they have this fundamental interface, but then the time they need it is over. But I think about when you have this fundamental interface, you have something like a port or, a temporary ostomy, you are subject to systems of maintenance and scrutiny and policing that you would not be during other times in your life, or if you did not need those technological accessories in any way. And accessories is not the right word here, but if you see what I'm getting at.
Yeah, I really like thinking the way you're thinking about it as material to reality and selfhood and a kind of personhood you can move in and out of, and Yeah, I really like thinking about it because for me, being born disabled, I think of it more and well, so far at least, having insurance, which is a privilege, to cover the leg that is my leg. I think I will be a cyborg, like always. But yeah, so that's just to say, I recognize that this could be something that you move in and you move out of. And for everyone watching, I mean, Ashley has written this brilliant piece I'm always talking about, Transmobility, with Mallory K. Nelson and Bethany, oh my God, I'm forgetting her last name, Stevens?
Stevens, yeah.
Yeah, okay. This is chronic pain for you. And do you want to talk about that at all?
Or maybe Transmobility is really Mallory's idea. And we were lucky to write it as a group of three of us. But Mallory is another amputee, a leg amputee. And I met her at a Society for Disability Studies meeting. And since then, we've been to multiple Amputee Coalition of America meetings together. It's nice to have your buddy who is like politically disabled with you, by which I mean, you know, we say it, but we also have like a politics that goes with it as well. On my first meeting her, she's like, I have this idea. And, you know, most people think of disability as limiting. Like that you're impaired, that you are deficient in some way. And then it's the medical systems, you know, they have to grapple with the deficiency. But Mallory, you know, has this idea of transmobility. And by transmobility, we're not talking transgender, we're talking about how disabled people can actually have more forms of mobility than most people. So this is this generative piece. So Mallory herself uses forearm crutches. Sometimes she uses a wheelchair at other times, depending on, you know, she thinks about what she's going to do each day. And then she picks out which tool she's going to use to do that. She had tried prosthetic legs earlier in her life, but what didn't work out for her. So she's had like different modes. And I think about how some amputees can use knee scooters. I think about the different ways in which we navigate different surfaces. And, you know, thinking about transmobility, that we actually have more possibility. It is a really weird thing for people to think about in relationship to disability, because people usually think about disability as foreclosing your options. However, it's not always true, right? So Mallory every day is thinking about what she's going to do, what she needs. She made it so that her wheelchair has her crutches that can sit on it, so that if she wants to pick up her crutches, get out of her wheelchair and do stairs or something like that, because she's really fast on crutches with stairs, and I'm very jealous of it. She can just like fly down, and like it's a whole case, and I cannot use crutches the way she can. So I am jealous, yes. And you know, when I think about using these tools, it's like really, really helpful, because so much of what we're told is amputees, and I think this probably is true for paraplegic people and a whole bunch of other people with mobility disabilities. So much of what we're told is that our lives are lesser. And we're also like supposed to buy into this narrative that we are pitiful in a particular way. And so much of what people want for us, not necessarily what we want, is to walk and to have a good gait. So you go to amputee meetings and it'll be like questions about how you walk. Questions about if you're pursuing prosthetics, questions about not about like what tools are you using that are helpful, what could we like share. It becomes, you know, have you gotten a good prosthetist, you know, can you walk, are you working, you know, with a physical therapist to get your gait looking right. And this is pressure from within the community and externally. Like so many of our messages that we're given is that walking is good and then everything else is bad. I really like some of the work of people like Bill Peace, who Jillian Weissa, of course, has more to say about, but he talks in his blog, Bad Cripple, about how walking is overrated. And he talks about our desire to see paraplegic people walk as a ritualized ideal that neglects the real lived experience of paraplegic people, right? And I think about his work so often. Because it is so much of why people, especially early on, in transitional stages, you know, becoming disabled is a lot harder than being disabled, right? That transition where you're seeing the limits because you haven't, you're having a whole new experience of your life if you're becoming disabled. You know, places stop feeling like home in the way they used to. You know, so much of what we read in media stories is about needing those technological fixes in order to be redeemed from your broken body. And transmobility points to this generative idea that, in fact, you have more ways of being in the world as a disabled person rather than a non-disabled person, especially if you think about lots of things as tools that can be useful sometimes, instead of thinking that there's one device that's going to fix you for all times. All right. Sorry, Jillian, I kind of.
No, I love it. I love this.
At the half hour mark.
Yeah, perfect.
Yeah.
Sorry.
We'll take a 5-minute break just to stretch and to be off screen if you want, and we'll be back.
Thank you.
Excellent. So, Ashley, I was thinking about the way you were talking about, like, how many more options disabled people have, and just how radical that must seem to non-disabled people, right? Like, what do you mean you have more options? But it seems that's something that I love about the Transmobility article. And something that I'm hoping catches on with the concept of cyborg. And like, I don't know if it's the right word or not, but I think subgroups or something that you were saying, like the umbrella term is I'm disabled and like, yeah, pride, et cetera. And then like there's all these different kinds of ways of being disabled that haven't quite been articulated, or some have, but my thought is that many have not been articulated because of the way the medical model continues to name. Do you think that's part of it, Ashley? I'm just wondering what's going on there.
You've mentioned, you know, Hollywood, you know, our depictions about disability, like whether they're from history, whether they're from Hollywood, whether they're from news media. Like I think about even when a factual story has been filed about anything related to disability, they're so often reifying like a limited number of ways to be disabled. And most of them aren't good. And the one they think is good is that we overcome our disabilities. Like something that transmobility does for me, and thinking about cyborgs too. In fact, we talk about cripborg as the concept that Bethany Stevens likes in relationship, because it is more explicit that when we're talking about cyborgs, we mean disabled people. We're gonna use this word crip at the front. You know, I think it does the same work of cyborg. But it's more in your face about that this is for disabled people. You know, I think one of the things this concept does it helps us think about technologies as useful tools, mm-hmm. right? That you could use one thing. There's not one perfect object for you that's going to solve all your problems, mm-hmm. right? In fact, most of us use an array of technologies, even if you're, you know, a wheelchair user by day. You know, you're using a shower chair to get in and out of the shower. Like there's additional equipment that it's going to take along the way, or auxiliary things that you're going to need to use for your life. And I think it really, so much of the narrative about technology and disability is that we need these technologies to redeem us, to make us good enough. And that we should be looking for that one technology that's going to do all those things, right? Whether it is an exoskeleton or a really fancy computerized leg. Once we find the thing, that's it. And then we've overcome and we're normal. We're normal again. So not only are we overcoming, we're superhuman, but we're also normal. It's a really weird kind of conversation that they give us about this. But are most of us, you know, being given an object doesn't mean that object's always going to work. Well, like what it needs to be on the inside when we talk about transmobility, it's not that your life is terrible because you're being maintained, right? Because you have to worry about this maintenance. Yes, these are just things that go with it. Mm-hmm. But it's not like we have to look for that one perfect thing. And in fact, no one thing will be perfect. And that's sort of a lesson from the history of philosophy of technology, right? That, there's no one cure-all for anything. That's not how anything actually works. But it speaks to sort of how to live well is to accept that you're going to have to be flexible and engaged, you know, being transmobile through a lot of these things. So for me, it's a source of our pride, right? Yeah. And people will talk about like disabled people as being ingenious at inventing hacks and ways around things. And I'm like, yes, they have learned to be transmobile, right? That is totally in line with what we have to be to negotiate so many of these systems. And it also helps, like, I think about just sort of the self-esteem that goes with it. Like, it erodes your self-esteem to be told every day that you're wrong. Jaypreet Verdi talks about this with hearing technologies in her Hearing Happiness book about, you know, reflecting on that in interviews. She's talked about, you know, if all your messages are that being deaf is bad and that you have to look for these technological solutions and none of them will be perfect, you know, that erodes something about you. You're supposed to always be hoping for something that doesn't exist. I think about that with walking too. Right. If you're told that the only way to be good is to walk and you have to wait for that technology to help you do it, well, it means that something's gone horribly wrong when you need your leg maintained, right? When your leg breaks, but you're the same person, right? And you might be doing the same things. It's just not the morality tale that people think it is, I guess. I don't know.
You just kind of define techno-ableism, which is your term for this. You really did just define it quite well in that last part. But my idea of why I love it so much is because now I can identify a techno-ableist moment and have a word for it, which, of course, going back to being a poet and a namer, it's so important to have language to describe the things that are techno-ableist, like any kind of technology that we really don't need, but a tribe work has invented for us because they think we need it. I'm trying to think of an example, like the stairs thing comes to mind. Like the, do you remember that, Ashley, the ridiculous, like instead of a ramp, we're gonna build like a thing that gets you up the stairs. Do you remember, like, that's a techno-ableist moment, yeah?
Yeah, no, and I like the way Disability Twitter puts a lot of these news stories on blast, right? They'll be reporting about a wheelchair that can get you upstairs. Now, neglect the fact that it looks like if you shift your body at all, well, you're going upstairs with that wheelchair, things will go terribly wrong. But the idea that like the fix needs to be with the individual and not the infrastructure, right? Yeah. You know, it's like when we think about the cost of ramps versus these very, very fancy, hard to maintain wheelchair situations that are one off and not commercially viable, mm-hmm. We're maintaining the wrong things in particular ways, like maintaining research about wheelchairs that move upstairs. I think about like, could you make better ramps and the ramps would serve everybody and you wouldn't have to have the very fancy wheelchair that looks like it's a tank to go upstairs. Can I share a screen? Because I really love this quote from you, and I want to explain.
Yeah.
Let's see. Yeah, here you are. And I like this for me encapsulates like how we get techno-ableist things, right? So you write, and this is from Common Cyborg, they like us best with bionic arms and legs. They like us deaf with hearing aids, though they prefer cochlear implants. It would be an affront to ask the hearing to learn sign language. Instead, they wish for us to lose our language, abandon our culture, and consider ourselves cured. They like exoskeletons, which none of us use. They would never consider cyborg those of us with pacemakers or on dialysis, those of us kept alive by machines or made ambulatory by wheelchairs, those of us on biologics or antidepressants. They want us shiny and metallic and in their image. I just love that quote from you, Jillian.
Thank you so much, Ashley. Thank you. Like, it took a while to write that essay because I kept thinking someone else will write it, which is often my writing process. Like, someone else will write this. Do I really need to go after Donna Haraway? And then I got tenure and was like, okay, fine, I'll write it. And because I kept seeing so much of these techno-ableist tropes, and it got redundant and philosophically unimaginative and ontologically incorrect. So thank you for bringing us to this passage. And I also am reminded that it expands the notion of what a cyborg can be, because I think a lot about, well, with like biologics or antidepressants, we're augmenting ourselves, our brains, our bodies. And so for me, it's a kind of wide open, inclusive identity. Yeah. So thank you.
Yeah, I know we were going to talk about, you know, what it's like to be a cyborg. So we've sort of touched on that, like the sort of societal messages we're receiving. What are some messages that you've received about your cyborghood?
Yeah, just no. That's the main message I've received, is no, you are not a cyborg. You cannot be a cyborg. You have a prosthetic leg. It is a fake leg, which has me interested actually quite a lot in fake studies, a field that doesn't exist but will, I'm convinced. But yeah, it took a long time to be like, wait a second, why are they calling me fake? Like, why are they calling my leg fake? Why is that okay? So that's the messaging. The messaging is no, you can't be a cyborg, because cyborgs are always in the future, and cyborgs are always they're not disabled people. That's definitely not a cyborg. A cyborg is like super able, maybe, or something. So yeah, that's been the messaging. And then like for being a sub, right now I'm in a space where I really need language and I don't have it, for being in between legs for 8 months. And so having two legs that I'm going back and forth, one is a German Ottobock leg that I've been on for 10 years. So my wisdom of that ontologically is like expert level, versus a new kind of leg called the Freedom leg, of course it is, from an American company. And the computer is so different that I think I will not continue with it. But okay, so I could say I'm body dysmorphic, but I'm really not body dysmorphic. I mean, I am, I suppose that's the only language that I have. But so I'm looking for language right now, cyborg language, to describe like, this is a feeling. This is a cyborg feeling of being between legs, between arms, between parts. And I don't know that it's body dysmorphia, because it's originating due to like this technology thing. I really love, and was thinking about your complaint about the maintenance of the staircase, like, who's going to maintain that shit? Well, also, I don't really like New York City, because the subways are not maintained, as far as the elevators do not work, or that one elevator at that one station doesn't work. And then what do you do? So, I wanted to jump back in time to that real quick. Like the idea of this maintenance and this, maintenance both of body and of like when there's some sort of techno-ableist idea, it introduces an entirely new kind of infrastructure maintenance when we can't even in the States keep up with that maintenance. I hope that Vienna is great at it. I have no idea. But
yeah, so I have a number of PhD students who are really interested in issues of maintenance. Susanna Hertigan and Joshua Earl and Damien Williams, who are all excellent scholars in their own right. So we talk about maintenance like all the time. And and maintenance is always in the background for me. Like I think that's part of the cyborg experience. If we're talking about it, people idealize what it's like to have a prosthetic leg. They're like, oh, you'll walk again and someday it will feel natural. And like natural is something we're supposed to prize and really want. And the fact is, it's fine. It's never the same, right? So you can get used to it. I remember having this conversation before I had my amputation. I was trying to find a good prosthetist. I called three different people and interviewed them on the phone. And the guy I went with was like, it's like I had a pep talk before I became an amputee that was basically like, people tell you, and the image of prosthetics is that they will change everything. They will make everything right again. They'll be good. I can make you good legs, he said. Yeah. Like, he wasn't playing down his skill, but it was going to be different for the rest of my life. And that I needed to get used to that idea that I couldn't search for perfection because of course it's material that'll break down. Like even if I feel really good, I leave the prosthetist's office and it's like, whoa, I'm riding this high. Everything's working right. And then I switch shoes. I put a different shoe on that foot. And all of a sudden my experience of walking is different. I'm always shifting. I moved from tennis shoes to sandals this week. It got warm enough, everybody. And it was like, oh, this is the worst. I have to think about every step I'm taking for a few days and trip a little bit here and there. And I did not fall before like I could move with confidence again. Yeah. Right. And that's just switching shoes because it got warm. That didn't happen when I had two meat legs.
And I mean, obviously that's a different experience than me being born disabled and being like working with prosthetics for so long, but like culturally raised to think of myself as not disabled, the family wanted me to pass for sure, even though I'm physically disabled and I also have scoliosis, so there is no passing. There's no option to disclose for me. But I resonate with your take on maintenance, and especially like how something very minor, some minor tweak can change one's entire experience of the world. I mean, I also resonate as a cyborg with like the ground playing such a huge factor. Like if someone wants me to come over, I'm thinking about, well, do they live on a hill? Is it grass? Is it gravel? Is it concrete? I think that's probably a disabled experience, not just a cyborg experience, but these are like things happening in our minds, right? That we are cataloging on a regular basis in a way when we encounter the world that other people don't think about as much. So what do we want, Ashley? Like, what do we, instead of like what we don't want, what do we want?
Oh, I think about not feeding into any of the narratives or tropes that we've been given. Like what we want is to be ourselves and not read through these lenses that insist for these other things. Like I worry about dancing in public.
Oh, okay. In
public, because someone will take a picture of me and call it inspirational.
Right.
Now, maybe in a picture, it's fine. If they got a video, they'd be like, this woman's the worst dancer in the world. But so I think about how we feed narratives and how our bodies feed stories that we don't care to be a part of.
Yeah.
I think about John Kinder, the historian who wrote Paying with Their Bodies. It's about veterans after war, post-World War I and World War II, where veterans' bodies were part of different campaigns, sometimes conflicting campaigns, like campaigns about the power of technology. Look, we're taking care of them by giving them the right technologies. And look, and it often features like a guy with a hook arm smoking, like that's overcoming right there. If you can get the lips, right? This has a certain cultural like era as part of it as well. So a lot of that messaging, but then also like anti-war campaigns. use veterans' bodies to suggest like the horrors of war encapsulated. Like, it's like veterans don't get to speak for themselves about their experiences. They get taken, pictures taken, and then used in all of these various ways. And their bodies are the story, not their voices. Mm-hmm. And I feel like so many times for disabled people, our bodies are stories for other people to project what they will on us.
Yeah.
And you know, it feeds into, you know, are you helping with awareness campaigns in the right way? Are you like, like, how can you use this? And, you know, I'd like to use it for more political purposes, right? If we're going to use it, I would like, you know, more people to have insurance, right?
Yeah.
Can that be the story my body tells and not one about like the human spirit in the face of adversity? Like,
yes.
The adversity is the medical system.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yes. Yes. The adversity is the medical system. Yes. Actually, I'm good if everyone is just kind of landing there and taking 5 minutes and then coming back to a Q&A. Is that good by everyone? Yeah. Okay. Perfect.